الحمد لله وكفى والصلاة والسلام على عباده الذين اصطفى خصوصا على أفضلهم وخاتم النبيين محمد الأمين وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين وبعد فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم ونزلنا عليك الكتاب بيانا لكل شيء وهدى ورحمة وبشرى للمسلمين صدق الله العظيم. We begin with Allah's blessed name. We praise Him and we glorify Him as He ought to be praised and glorified. And we pray for peace and for blessings on all His noble messengers, and our father Adam, and our father Abraham, and on Moses, and on Jesus, and on His mother, the Blessed Virgin Mary, and on the last of them all, the Blessed Prophet MUHAMMED sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam. Brother Chairman, brothers and sisters, assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullah. Our topic is entitled Yajuj and Majuj, or Gog and Magog in the Quran. It is an unusual topic. It is, I believe, the first time that it's being addressed in this country. But it is a topic of supreme importance. But more than that, it is a topic which could not have been addressed prior to this time, because it could not have been understood. What the Quran was saying on this subject, and what the Blessed Prophet, Allah's blessings be upon him, has said on this subject, could not have been understood until events had unfolded in history. We have now reached that point in the historical process where it is possible, through Allah's kindness, to understand the subject. It would not be possible, however, in an hour and a half, and I've already lost 15 minutes of my hour and a half, to complete the subject. What we will attempt to do is to give you sufficient material, information, analysis of the verses of the Quran and of the sayings of the Prophet, Allah's blessings be upon him, which could give you the framework of the subject, a grasp of the heart of the subject. There is, however, a chapter of this book entitled Gog and Magog in the Quran. And what cannot be conveyed to you in the lecture, you can read it in this book, which is available at the back. The Arabs of Arabia, the tribe of the Quraysh, which traced its ancestry to Ishmael, alayhi salam, and which had custodianship over the holy temple, the house of Allah, the Kaaba in Arabia, built by Abraham, alayhi salam, on the spot where our father Adam had worshipped. These Arabs did not know how to deal with the phenomenon of one who had emerged from within their midst, who had lived with them for 40 years, who had never told a lie, now he declared, I am a prophet, like unto Ishmael, alayhi salam, like unto Moses, alayhi salam, like unto Jesus, alayhi salam, like unto my father Abraham, alayhi salam. A man named Muhammad, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They finally decided, let us send a delegation to the rabbis, the Jews, who are located in the city of Medina to the north of Mecca, in a significant number. Why were the Jews in Arabia, in that city? Now that's a nice story we'd like to tell you sometime. The question was indirect. The target of the question was actually Gog and Magog. They wanted to know whether he knew about Gog and Magog, who were one of the major signs of the last day. In response to that question, which was posed to the Prophet ﷺ, together with the other two questions, revelation came down in the Quran. And the answer was placed in a surah of the Quran, or chapter of the Quran, called Suratul Kahf, or the cave. And that is our topic for next month's lecture. So you've got to come back next month. This is the answer. And they question thee, O Muhammad, alayhi salatu wasalam, about Dhulqarnain, or the traveler is Dhulqarnain. Qarn means a horn, so Qarnain could mean two horns, shades of Daniel, the dreams of Daniel, two horns. Qarn can also mean an age, an epoch. And so Qarnain would be two ages. Which of these two? Which of these two meanings shall be utilized for understanding this name given to this great traveler? Nowhere in the Quran has the word Qarn been used to mean horn. Everywhere in the Quran that the word Qarn is used, it means an age or an epoch. And so Dhulqarnain is a man who impacts upon two ages, one in the past, one to come. That's today. He is someone who possesses faith. Faith in the one God. The one God who created both the male and the female, but is neither male nor female. In the United States, they're saying that God is both a man and a woman now. He has faith in the one God, the God of Abraham, besides whom there is no other God. And that God has given him power. Power. Divinely bestowed power. When power rests on the foundations of faith, how is that power used? I hope that the PNM is listening. I hope that the UNC might one day also listen. When power rests on the foundations of faith, how is that power used? I do hope someday Washington might listen. Dhulqarnain travels in one direction. He's going in the direction of the setting of the sun, so west. And there he comes across a people. He reaches a lake of murky water, deep water, so an ocean, not a little pond. And then he comes across a people. And then Allah addresses him and says, "Oh, Zulkarnain, how are you going to relate with these people?" He replied, he said, "Those who are guilty of acts of